Ever watched a science fiction movie and wondered whether the world could really ever be that fantastic? Whether people alive today will live on Mars, teleport around the world, or even travel through time? If these things sound fantastic to you now, just think how far we've come in the last 100 years. This century has seen man progress from horse-drawn carriages to moonwalks, and yet the scientific revolution is only just beginning. If you've ever wondered whether the science of tomorrow can fulfill the spectacular promises of today's science fiction, then welcome to Future Fantastic. Of all science fiction's claims, the longest and the loudest has been that we are not alone. A growing number of scientists agree. They're coming around to the possibility of intelligent life outside this planet. While the experts speculate on what these extraterrestrials may look like and what message they may bring, they're sure of one thing. When we make contact, it will be the most profound event since man first left the confines of this tiny planet.
One day, we will open our hearts and our minds to the presence of living forms beyond our planet. One day, we will make contact with them. Only then will we truly understand ourselves and our place in this universe.
Story Musgrave, astronaut. He's flown 5 shuttle missions and is as comfortable floating in space as he is back on Earth. Who better to ask about the possibility of other life in our universe?
I know when I'm out in space that there is life out there. I know that from a logical, common sense point of view, but I also tend to feel it intuitively. The acceptance of other living beings out there, that's the beginning of a joint effort. That's the beginning of communication.
Story Musgrave isn't alone. NASA takes the idea of aliens very seriously. In 1992, it put $100 million into a project to listen to alien messages from the stars.
The extraterrestrials happen to be rather close to us. They might know of our existence. They might have been picking up early radar experiments or early TV, for that matter, from the late 30s or the 40s. And that probably means they would send pictures, pictures that show themselves, what they look like physically, what their astronomical situation is. And it would probably be a mini encyclopedia about their own culture.
Just think how valuable an alien encyclopedia could be. Overnight, it would advance our understanding of science by thousands of years. But decoding this fantastic knowledge won't be easy.
The civilizations we detect may be far more advanced than we are, may use coding methods, communication methods, which are very difficult or impossible for us to decode. And of course, that will be disappointing. But my hope is that they will be transmitting signals in a way we can decode and which we can use to learn about them immediately, without having to ask questions and waiting perhaps thousands of years for answers.
And already scientists are thinking hard about how we on Earth might reply.
If the civilization we're listening to is 100 light years away, there's no real hurry to reply. It's going to take 100 years for the reply to get there anyhow. But if we do decide to answer, we answer as one planet, all right, all humankind. Bring in the United Nations. Have everybody decide what it is we should say, if anything. So that's the policy. I think the practicality will be a little different. I think anybody who has a transmitter will probably aim it in the direction of where this signal's coming from and broadcast their own reply, but we'll see.
But we're getting ahead of ourselves. In 30 years, we've had nothing but intergalactic silence. Anything else is just wishful thinking.
There really was a message. Yes, from a planet A very distant planet, somewhere in Andromeda.
That's right.
Well, that is a comfortable way away.
Since the 1960s, it's become even harder to hear the messages from Andromeda. The radio pollution now surrounding our planet could well be hiding weak alien signals.
When an extraterrestrial signal actually makes its way into our radio telescopes, I hope that it's me that's there to receive the signal.
Dr. Jill Tarter is the head of Project Phoenix, the latest and most advanced search. She has big plans to escape this Earthbound interference.
The next step may well take us to the far side of the moon, which always looks away from Earth, is always shielded from our own technology and our own interference by the body of the moon, and gives us a very stable base on which to build large arrays of telescopes for permanently listening.
But maybe interference isn't the problem at all. Maybe the aliens just aren't sending any messages.
What if extraterrestrials are leaving clues for us, out there in the unimaginable vastness of space? Messages that are safely hidden until we're advanced enough to find them.
I think that contact would be the most important event in human history because it will tell us whether we're nearer the apes or the angels.
Arthur C. Clarke, the world's most influential science fiction writer, explored the idea of hidden alien messages in his most famous work, 2001, A Space Odyssey. In the film, the sleek black monoliths emit a mysterious force that accelerate human evolution. They're hidden in space to ensure that this dangerous knowledge would only be available to us when we were advanced enough to find it. Dr. Clarke still believes that this is a very real possibility.
I put the second monolith on the moon, the idea being that, you know, until we qualified, got out of the nursery school and got there, no one would be interested in us. There may be other artifacts scattered around the solar system, perhaps in the asteroid belt. But this is perfectly possible, and we should keep our eyes open for this. We should also keep our eyes open for archaeological evidence.
And in the immediate future, those eyes are the probes we sent deep into space. The Viking 1 orbiter has already sent back many stunning pictures of other planets, and one of them caused quite a stir. This image from Mars is of a face a mile across. A freak rock formation, or the face of some long-lost alien god cast in their own image? Over the years, we've depicted ETs in many ways, but scientists have argued that it's impossible to imagine anything we don't understand. Others say, so what's to imagine?
There are a growing number of people who can tell you exactly what an alien looks like. They've met them.
All of us need to keep an open mind about abductions, because the implications of abductions are so important that if true, they could affect all mankind.
Dr. Richard Haynes, mild-mannered NASA psychologist by day, but by night he investigates UFO sightings and abductions. And occasionally Dr. Haynes is impressed. Take the case of Kathy and Susan, who under hypnosis came up with the same remarkable story.
This is a very interesting case because it qualifies as a multiple abduction, where two people claim to be abducted at the same time in the same place. The two women were driving along pretty fast. There's not much traffic that night. And all of a sudden, Susan says, "Look at the moon over there." And Kathy says, "Susan, that's not the moon. The moon's over here." Well, Kathy puts on the brakes and Susan jumps out of the car and starts running towards the object. Susan tells me under hypnosis that she watches the object come over her and stop over the car. A white beam of light comes out the bottom of it, and Kathy is seen rising up this beam. The next thing both of them remember is sitting in the same car, side by side, 16 miles up that same road, with no recollection how they got there. And my impression of these women is that they are serious, sensible people who have nothing to gain, no money to be made, for instance. They don't want no publicity. They weren't out to fool me, I don't think.
Maybe the women weren't out to fool anybody. It's a typical abduction story, and the remarkable thing is that 1% of Americans feel they've had the same experience. The abduction bandwagon started rolling in 1961, when Betty and Barney Hill became the first people to reveal that they'd been forced into an alien aircraft, subjected to alien medical probes, and then dumped back to Earth. Similar stories and descriptions of aliens have been repeated thousands of times since then. Is this consistency evidence of truth, or a shared fantasy from the realms of science fiction?
I haven't found any evidence to believe that science fiction movies have played a significant role. That in the symbology or the descriptions of the craft or the technology they see, I find no correlations in an American science fiction.
I think it's quite likely that in 10 years that the claims that people make about UFO abductions will be even more outlandish and bizarre than the ones they're making today.
Robert Schaefer, software engineer and hard-nosed UFO investigator, has studied the links between abductions and science fiction.
Some of the ufologists are going around saying that there's absolutely nothing in the science fiction literature that is like these UFO abduction stories, and that is simply flat wrong. 30 years before Betty Hill reported her UFO abduction, we find in a Buck Rogers comic strip a UFO abduction that's startlingly like the ones that we're familiar with today, where there's a hovering craft of the Tigermen from Mars hovers over this woman, Wilma, and reaches down a large mechanical claw and grabs her and pulls her in. They put her on a table and they do a mind scan. And, of course, this is just exactly what the aliens are supposed to be doing today.
The early science fiction movie, Invaders from Mars, has striking similarities to the story Betty Hill revealed under hypnosis.
Let her go! Tell her to let her go! Let her go! Tell her to let her go! You've been anything to my mom and dad!
Barney Hill talked under hypnosis about this alien with the wraparound eyes, which is a rather interesting and unique feature for an alien, at least at that time. An episode of The Outer Limits had been on TV just a few days before this hypnosis session, and it had an alien of that rather interesting description in it.
Since the Hills' abduction, there has been a steady trickle of cases, nearly all featuring the same alien, the so-called Gray. But in the mid-70s, that trickle would become a flood.
When aliens make contact with us, we're going to find out how accurately we guessed their appearance. We're also going to find out how accurately they guessed what we would look like in their own versions of science fiction.
John Clute, author of the Encyclopedia of Science Fiction, agrees that this Gray isn't from a distant galaxy, but from Hollywood.
Every ectomorphic alien with great big eyes, every alien who appeals to us because it's so childlike we cannot resist it, is an alien that comes straight out of either E.T. or Close Encounters, which Spielberg made a few years earlier. Many, many people who now believe they've been abducted by aliens believe they've been abducted by Steven Spielberg, in effect. And what can you say? What can you say about that kind of belief? I don't really know what to say politely.
Since Close Encounters, the number of reported abductions has rocketed. But these accounts all have one fundamental problem.
The people that have been abducted, if they could bring us just the smallest amount of biological material back, or parts of that spaceship, or anything at all, it would be absolutely magnificent. They never bring anything back.
So how has science fiction explained this lack of hard evidence? Well, it's brilliantly simple. The evidence has been there all along. It's just been covered up. Someone's not being straight with us.
If any government has been contacted by an alien race, you can bet that they're using the alien knowledge they've been given for their own good.
David Bischoff, a science fiction author who writes at the classic conspiracy theory that governments are already working with aliens here on Earth.
There's a great relationship between science fiction and the conspiracy theories involving governments, particularly because science fiction itself has given us so many images of alien contact, of alien invasion, and clearly, if people believe that, in fact, we are being contacted, then the government's the entity that's suppressing that information.
But if a government really has made contact with aliens, as science fiction insists, where could the evidence be hidden? Britain is too small. So one suggestion is here, Area 51, a secret military base in the heart of the Nevada desert. The guards patrol the perimeter constantly in unmarked jeeps, and the penalty for crossing the boundary is death.
Area 51 is only the best-known secret base in a vast military complex where anything could be true.
Glenn Campbell quit his job as a computer programmer and moved to Nevada to try to find the truth behind the base, where it's rumored the military keeps several captured alien spacecraft. The American government denies the base exists, but Russian satellite photos tell the real story.
What we see at about 25 miles distance here is what looks like an ordinary Air Force base. There's a number of large hangars. There is probably the longest runway in the world. This was the testing ground for the U-2 and the SR-71 spy planes. It was built to counter the Soviet threat. Now we have no Soviet threat. The question is, why is it so secret?
30 miles from the base lies the tiny desert town of Rachel, a trailer park community that is enjoying the area's newfound notoriety.
Well, I'm rather sure, my own personal feelings, that there are in fact alien beings over there.
They are in Area 51, the ETs or aliens or whatever you want to call them.
I think there's always been weird things there. Yeah, secret crafts. Military crafts, I don't know.
I think the government's entitled to a bit of secrecy for their testing and things that us mere mortals know nothing about.
We don't even know who runs this base. We don't know who their bosses are. We don't know if they report to the Air Force or to the President or whoever. We don't know that there's any accountability at all out here. This is only the best known base of a vast secret complex the size of the state of Connecticut all behind me here. There are a lot of little valleys and desert nooks where you could hide secret facilities, where you could hide anything you want, where you honestly could keep alien craft secret. And I find that very interesting. In all my time here, what I've come to see is that the military really could keep a secret this big and keep control over its employees so the secret did not get out.
From the midst of the half-truths and misinformation surrounding the desert base comes one man, a solitary witness to the secrets hidden in Area 51.
I have worked on extraterrestrial vehicles, also referred to as flying saucers, for the United States government.
Bob Lazar claims he was an engineer, employed to examine one of 9 alien spacecraft held here.
The emotions, the feeling that I felt inside when I first entered the craft are quite different from what you'd expect. It's a very ominous feeling, a feeling as if you shouldn't be there. I know that sounds kind of corny, but that is truly, truly how I felt.
Lazar's story is contentious, to say the least. He says he obtained maximum security clearance to join a team of engineers whose job was to duplicate the sophisticated engine of the alien craft.
The propulsion system is quite exotic. It's a gravity propulsion system. There's no propeller, there's no jet exhaust, there's no obvious mode of propulsion. What the craft does, it sets up its own gravitational field. It amplifies that gravitational field, phase shifts it, and uses that to lift the craft off the ground, kind of an anti-gravity, more or less. The first time I saw the disc fly, it lifted virtually silently off the ground. We're looking at something about 52 feet in diameter, just hovering silently in the air. It drifted over to the left, to the right, and then set back down. Pretty uneventful test, but it was quite impressive.
Lazar doesn't claim to know where these disks in the desert came from, or even what they're made of. Whether you're convinced by his story or not, few people will be satisfied until hard evidence appears.
I've heard people claiming that, sure, this guy, Lazar, is just making up the story, he's a hoaxer, so on and so forth, but my response to them would be, why? Why on earth would I do something like that? This has certainly not been a benefit to my life. It's something that's haunted me.
What do we make of Bob Lazar's story? Maybe he's telling it straight. Maybe he's mistaken advanced military technology for alien hardware. Or maybe he's been reading too much science fiction.
If scientists thought that there was even the slightest chance that some of this were true, you would have hordes of university physicists and astronomers and whatever else, biologists, applying for grants to study this phenomenon. They'd be all over themselves asking for money to do that, and they're not.
So what will happen when the alien arrives? As long ago as 1960, a leaked report prepared for NASA suggested that the alien might spell trouble. Today, the scientists are strikingly more optimistic about the day we will finally learn we are not alone.
If you've just woken up, I can tell you there's only one story this morning, confirmation from the White House that an unidentified craft has landed on Earth. We can't yet confirm
the acceptance
exactly
of other civilizations out there is going to bring us together. And that contact is going to bring us together, not destroy us.
I can tell you the expectation here at the White House is overwhelming. We're expecting a statement any second now.
Every aspect of human life will be altered in a significant way. Our morals, our forms of entertainment, our values, all of these things will be greatly affected for the better, for our benefit, by what we learn from other civilizations.
There were survivors at the crash site. I've seen the evidence. At last, there is proof.
There's an upside to communication, and that is you're suddenly given an encyclopedia for a culture that's far in advance of your own. That's the upside. The downside is it might do you in. Think of asking a tribe in central Borneo 100 years ago, hey, look, we're going to put you in contact with the advanced civilizations of Europe. You think that there's any danger for you if we do that? Well, there is some danger. They might lose their will to develop their own culture further. Their traditions, all that sort of thing might go. We might be in the same position.
Science fiction introduced us to the alien. And while the scientists must wait for proof, the signals or alien debris that would confirm their existence, it's the writers and the filmmakers who have inspired the scientists to look and may even have prepared us for what they might find. Now, no one knows how it will change us, but contact with other species in our universe will be one of the most exciting adventures that awaits us in our fantastic future.
And at the same time tomorrow, Gillian Anderson contemplates the possibility of time travel. But next, she assesses our increasing reliance on robots in more future fantastic on UK TV documentary.